Have you ever wondered what the future holds? What changes are occurring now that will impact our lives and our world tomorrow? And more importantly, who are starting all these changes? Hi everyone, I am Elena Bou and this is Join the Curious. A series of inspiring talks for challenging minds, where we will explore innovation and sustainability alongside the most prominent pioneers from different fields, including academia, politics, research, technology, and business. Why don't you join us? So hello, Bo, hello, Steve. I mean, it's a great pleasure for me to be here with both of you. Just to start with, I mean, how you see the battery market, what is happening, for instance, in US and in Europe?
Everything that has a combustion engine eventually will be battery powered.
It is a huge market, but there is room for improvement, especially in cost, longevity, and how fast can you charge.
There are many tipping points. It's about when you can have the cost, when you can have the range, when you can have the charging capacity. But all of these tipping points we seem to be able to tick off in the near future. We will see a double exponential growth in this market. So for me, that will probably be the biggest challenge to find skilled people to lead this massive transformation, because And some can be retrained, but of course you have to, I think there will be a resource limitation on skills. And I see that happening already. There is like a war on skills already in the battery field.
The cost of materials for a battery is 30% of the cost of the battery. But if you imagine growing hundreds of fold, 1,000-fold in market, that the demand on those materials will go skyrocket.
In method will be improved to extract the minerals. We have now four companies that have raised their hand and said they want to start extracting lithium in Europe.
We can extract lithium from seawater. If that turns out to be true, you've just increased the resource of lithium by about 10,000-fold. So lithium goes out of the picture. The other ones were the cobalt especially, but manganese and nickel are not far behind. And if we get sulfur, that comes out of the picture. There's a real hope that sulfur can replace these metals and even have still higher energy density.
We have seen in the news, we have seen in our meetings, that traditional, for instance, automotive industry or other incumbents, they are gearing, they are changing minds, they are changing strategies. What's happening?
If you look at the big OEMs in Europe, all of them have CEOs that have been on the chair for 1 year or less. So it's a dramatic shift.
One of the things, for example, is if it takes 4 hours to charge your car, that has a problem.
Yes.
If it takes 5 minutes to go 150 miles, there is no problem.
Yeah.
And some of these people are convinced that will never happen. But if you look at the internal resistance of the battery, what's fundamentally going on, these are all solvable problems.
It's difficult to predict the future, we say.
Yes.
But I have always advocated that in battery, it's not so difficult. We can be pretty sure there will be significant improvements in cost and performance.
And you look at the specs that the OEMs are putting out nowadays, they're just ratcheting them up and up.
Yep.
And industry's responding. So that's the good news. The last one is the fast charging. You do really want fast charging, because that will completely, everybody parks in the streets. and for a city to put chargers on streets is not really practical. There needs to be a revolution in biology/agriculture. If you look at the amount of greenhouse gases from agricultural land use, it's more than electricity generation around the world.
If we can solve the issue of which I believe we can, produce electricity for very low cost, so many things will come after that.
I think that in the conversation that we had, you mentioned that 80% of the charging is going to be done at home, yeah, at work. And are we prepared for that? Are our cities prepared for that?
I think we may not need that. What I'm hoping comes true, if you get fast charging in the lab in less than 10 years, then you get it in cars in less than 15 or 16 years. It takes about 5 or 6 years to get into a car. If you do that, and this is before your 10% of the market, or about 10% of the market, then you say, then you have service station model. You send several megawatts, which is special line, to service station every couple of kilometers. People don't mind waiting 5 minutes. In fact, most of the profits in gasoline stations, petrol stations, is not from selling gasoline. It's from selling candy bars and magazines.
So I tend to believe that we will have the cars will be a part of the power system with vehicle to grid. I think I was not so much friend of that idea in the past. Today I'm increasingly interested in it because we will see that the vehicles, when plugged in, which and they are most of the time standing idle, they can have a significant contribution to the power system.
So. Well, Steve, thank you very much for this nice conversation.
All right, thank you.
Thank you all for being here with us, and stay tuned for the next chapter of Join the Curious, where we will explore another unique topic and the mind behind it. Are you already curious about it?